In this video, we're gonna give a proof of the Skolem-Nether theorem. This is one of the most fundamental theorems of the theory of central symbol algebras. Later, we will show how we could use Skolem-Nether to compute the Brow group of the reals and as well as the Brow groups of finite fields by proving Frobenius theorem and Wedderburn's theorem. Most importantly, we are gonna use Skolem-Nether to motivate the definition of group cohomology. Alright, so what's the theorem about? Roughly speaking, the Skolem-Nether theorem classifies all the automorphisms of a central symbol K algebra. It says that all automorphisms of such a central symbol K algebra S are gonna be inner, that is, they are gonna be given by conjugation by elements of S. Recall that a ring is cosymbol if it has no non-trivial two-sided ideal, and a K-algebra is cocentral if its center is equal to K. A more precise version of Skolem-Nether is as follows. So let's say that S is a central symbol K-algebra of finite dimension over K. Now let R be another simple K-algebra, not necessarily central. Then we claim that any two K-algebra homomorphisms from R to S must differ by an inner automorphism of S. In other words, if F1 and F2 are two K-algebra homomorphisms from R to S, then there must exist some inner automorphism alpha of S, such that F2 is just going to be alpha composed with F1. Now, in the specific case when R is S and F1 is identity, the theorem just says that every automorphism F2 of S is inner. Note that these maps Fi have to be injective, and thus R must also be a finite dimension over K, and this is very important. But why must these maps be injective? Well, that's because the kernel of these maps must be a two-sided ideals of R, but R is simple. So the kernel can either be trivial or the whole of R. Now the kernels of these maps can be the whole of R, because these maps are K-algebra homomorphisms. So in particular, they cannot send the whole of K to zero. Thus, both of these maps are injective, and thus R itself is finite dimensional over K. The fact that both R and S are finite dimensional simple K-algebra is the key. This is because finite dimensional simple K-algebra have two very important properties. The first one is that they can be realized as endomorphism rings of some modules. And the second key property of simple finite dimensional K-algebra is that modules over such algebras are uniquely determined by their dimension. So let us see how both of these come into play in Skolem-Nether. Now, as we said, S is a finite dimension over K and simple, so S can be realized as the endomorphism ring of some module M over some division algebra D. Now, why is it useful to view S this way? Well, if we view S as the endomorphism ring of M over D, then we can view each Fi as giving M an R module structure. This is because each Fi associate to every element in R some endomorphism of M. So we can use it to define an R module structure on M. Let us denote by M1 and M2 the R module structures on M induced by F1 and F2 respectively. So now to understand the relationship between F1 and F2, we want to understand the relationship between these modules. And to understand the relationship between these R modules, we need to understand the ring R. And here again is where we use the fact that R is a simple finite dimensional K algebra. Any two modules over such algebra that are of the same dimension must be isomorphic. The reason is because if A is a simple finite dimensional K algebra, or more generally, if A is a simple Artinian ring, then there is a unique simple A module M. And in particular, every finite dimensional A module is gonna be a direct sum of copies of that simple A module M. So two A modules are of the same dimension if and only if they are the direct sum of the same number of copies of M, in which case they must be isomorphic. Thus, modules over simple finite-dimensional k-algebra are uniquely determined by their dimension over k. Now, coming back to our situation, when we view S as the endomorphism ring of some module M, we get two R-module structure on M. But as we said, R is simple and finite-dimensional over k, so these two R-modules, M1, M2, must be isomorphic. In other words, there must exist some isomorphism phi, which makes the following square commutative for every little r in R. In particular, we see that F2 is just F1 conjugated by phi. The problem though is that we want F2 to be F1 conjugated by something in S. And phi is not necessarily in S, because even though phi is an endomorphism of M, phi does not necessarily commute with D. So how do we ensure that phi actually commutes with D so that it becomes an element of S? Now observe that these map Fi have image in S. So that means that the R-module structures that they induce on M must commute with D. So actually, they give two R tensor D module structures. So not just R module structure, but R tensor D module structures. But then we have to be careful, just because these modules are R tensor D module does not necessarily mean that this map phi is gonna be an R tensor D module homomorphism. Because we got this map phi from the uniqueness of R module of any dimension, so we only know that this map phi is R linear. We do not know whether or not it's linear over R tensor D. But that's okay because we don't necessarily have to use that map. It turns out that R tensor D itself is also simple and of finite dimension over K. So then any two R tensor D modules of the same dimension must be isomorphic. And thus we can get an isomorphism between M1 and N2 as R tensor D modules. In particular, this map phi here is an endomorphism of M that is linear over D, so we can identify it with some element of S, say S0. Now, since S0 is a homomorphism of R modules, arguing as before, we see that S0 F1 must be equal to F2 S0. In other words, F2 is just going to be equal to S0 inverse F1 S0. So F2 and F1 differ by conjugation by an element in S, as claimed. Now to make this argument, we have used the fact that this tensor product is a simple finite dimensional k-algebra, so why is that? It is a finite dimension because both R and D are of finite dimension over K. Indeed, S is just going to be isomorphic to a matrix algebra over D, and so since S is a finite dimension over K, D must also be a finite dimension over K. The reason why this ring is simple is a bit more complicated, and the full exposition is gonna be in another video. The basic idea is that D is a central simple k-algebra. It's simple because it's a division ring, so every non-zero element is a unit, hence it cannot have any proper two-sided ideal. And it's central because, as we said, S is a matrix algebra over D. And the center of any matrix algebra over D is just gonna be equal to the center of D. So the center of D must be equal to the center of S, which was assumed to be K, because we have said that S is central simple. Now the significance of the fact that D is central simple is that then we know every two-sided ideals of tensor product of D with any other K-algebra. If R is any other K-algebra, then every two-sided ideal of R tensor with D must be of the form I tensor D, where I is a two-sided ideal of R. So, in particular, if R is simple, like in our case, then I can only be trivial or R, so that means that R tensor with D has no non-trivial two-sided ideal. Thus, R tensor with D must also be simple. And then, since R tensor D is simple and a finite dimension over K, the two R tensor D module structure induced on M via F1 and F2 must be isomorphic. That isomorphism commutes with D, so must correspond to some element in S. And thus we see that we can obtain F2 by conjugating F1 by some element of S. In particular, we have shown that all automorphism of a central simple K-algebra are inner.